各位法师，各位道友，大家晚上好。阿弥陀佛，首先请大家发菩提心。
Good evening, all teachers and Dharma friends this evening. Let's begin the teaching by making an aspiration of bodhicitta as our basic motivation.
那么菩提心呢，我们前几天给大家介绍过了。但是呢，我们每天都要提心提醒大家发菩提心。那么以后呢，我们修行的时候也自己要给自己提心提醒自己发菩提心我们烧香拜佛诵经念咒磕头等等等等，做任何善事的时候都要提醒自己要自己要给自己提醒，一定要发菩提心这个非常的重要。
So we've talked a lot about the importance of bodhicitta over the last few evenings, but I'm going to still remind you about it again tonight. It's important that you also remind yourselves of the importance of bodhicitta when you're engaging in any kind of positive conduct, whether that be making offerings, reading sutras, prostrating, etc. It's important that we know how to remind ourselves of the importance of bodhicitta.
菩提心这个真实的菩提心真实的菩提心，那这个功德就是不可思议的不仅仅是这个真实的标准的菩提心有功德然后这个比较不太标准的就是早着的这个菩提心被动的菩提心也有非常大的功德。
The merit and the virtue of genuine bodhicitta is inconceivable. But even relative bodhicitta, bodhicitta that is more contrived in nature, still has very significant merit.
不仅仅是这个早着的菩提心有功德啊，大乘佛教里面讲，比如说你假装啊发菩提心，其实根本就没有想发菩提心，但是假装发菩提心也有功德的。
The Mahayana sutras say that even if one doesn't have sincere bodhicitta, even the pretense of having bodhicitta, putting on an act of having it, even has its own merit.
假装发菩提心为什么有功德？这个从表面上看起来就是有一点不好理解啊。但是呢，因为这个菩提心是非常非常伟大的善根啊，所以就是连假装的啊菩提心，就是也可以给我们啊播下一个啊这个菩提心的种子，所以呢也是有功德的。
The fact that pretended bodhicitta would have merit is something that seems on the surface very difficult to understand. But the reason this is the case is because the merit of bodhicitta is so immense that even if we're only pretending to have it, it's still possible of sowing a positive karmic seed in our consciousness.
为了修菩提心，为了修出这个标准的菩提心，我们。 花一辈子的时间来修也是值得的。
Even if we spend our entire lives cultivating bodhicitta, then this time is still worth it.
因为有了菩提心以后呢，就是已经有一个非常好的开头。那么这个有了这个开头以后呢，以后的所有的事情。 就在这个菩提心的基础上，那就一切都非常的顺利，非常的有意义。所以，就是有一个这样子的菩提心的开头是非常非常重要的。Bodhicitta
serves as a very, very excellent beginning or foundation for everything else that comes after it or comes upon it. Once we have bodhicitta, then many other things take care of themselves, as it were. So bodhicitta is a very, very important foundation.
所以，希望大家进一步的去学习这个菩提心的具体的修法。然后呢，菩提心的理论还有就是菩提心的很多的具体的修法全面的。 这个介绍菩提心的大乘佛教的论点，就是入菩萨心论，这个是这本书是全面的介绍了菩提心，全面的这个讲述菩提心的功德以及菩提心的本质和菩提心的修法，这个是最好的，所以希望大家去学习。
I very much hope that everybody goes on to study and learn more about bodhicitta, in particular, how to go about cultivating it, how to go about practicing bodhicitta. In terms of the theoretical aspects of bodhicitta and the concrete aspects of bodhicitta practice, there's really no better text than the Way of a Bodhisattva. This text contains much description of the virtue, the merit of bodhicitta, as well as how to go about cultivating it.
入菩萨心论，这个论点呢，在藏传佛教里面是一个非常重要的论点。这个在藏传佛教里面的地位相当的高，所以在藏传佛教里面，这个入菩萨心论的解释，比较著名的、比较标准的解释都有100多本，100多位上师，这个写注解解释，这个《入菩萨心论》。The
Way of a Bodhisattva has an extremely important place in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. It's such an important text that there are over 100 different commentaries by different masters on this root text.
然后也有很多这个引渡的这些菩萨学者写的这个如菩萨行论的解释，大概就有二十多种解释。
So in addition to the 100 or so commentaries by Tibetan masters, there are also around 20 masters by various Indian masters and scholars.
那么这些每一个都是相当好的，然后这些藏传佛教的这些解释，也就是说这个藏族的这些上师们写的这些注解当中呢，有一个最殊胜的，大家都认为最最最殊胜的是有一个上师叫做托密。 托密仁波切，因为他是一个非常了不起的一个菩萨，非常有慈悲心，非常有菩提心的一个这个菩萨，所以他写的这个注解，他写的是不是讲太多太多的复杂的东西，比较简单的，但是呢，非常有加持的，这个大家都认为是最好的。
Of the many of the 100 or so commentaries on the way of a bodhisattva by different Tibetan masters, the most famous and probably one of the most well regarded is one penned by Tokme Rinpoche. It's not a particularly complicated text, it's not particularly difficult, but it's regarded as a very excellent commentary. Togme Rinpoche was a master with great, great bodhicitta himself. He was a bodhisattva, and so his text has great blessing power.
那么这个托梅仁波切的这个解释，苏大吉堪布从藏文已经翻译了这个汉文，现在大家都可以去看，应该网上应该有的，然后呢也有。 英文版，英文版，这中文英文都有了，所以我们现在想看英文也有英文的，想看这个中文也有中文的，这个轮是一定要学的，这么好的轮，有机会学，有这些所有的资料，但是呢，我们不学，这个是非常可惜的，非常的遗憾。
So this commentary by Togme Rinpoche has already been translated into Chinese by Khenpo Sodagi, and it's probably available online. It's also available in an English version too. So it's very accessible, and it's very important that we study this text. If we don't, this is a very, very unfortunate situation, and it's a great shame if we don't study it.
我们这一生当中，最幸福的应该是什么呢？应该就是有这么好的这些大乘佛教的轮典，我们有机会去学，那么就是我们能够看得懂这些文字，然后呢，我们也有很多的这些资料，有这个机会，我觉得这个是我们的最幸福的。
Probably one of the most happy things that we have available to us is the opportunity to read these scriptures from the Mahayana tradition and have so many different sources available to help us understand their meaning.
然后我们每一个人的人生当中也有很多很多的遗憾，每个人都会有自己认为是遗憾的有很多，但是 真正的遗憾就是我们有这么好的这个书，有这么这个好的机会，还不去学习，还不去用，那么这个就是真正的人生当中的最大的遗憾。
Over the course of any person's life, there are all kinds of things that we regret, all things that we wish had happened otherwise. However, really, the thing that should be of greatest regret is that there exist such wonderful scriptures, such wonderful texts, yet we don't take the opportunity to study them and understand their contents.
然后这个如菩萨行论
There are videos available with Khenpo Sordaji giving a commentary on the way of a bodhisattva. There are also many such commentaries available by other Tibetan lamas, but they're probably all in English. In any case, there's the commentary, the video commentary by Khenpo Sordaji and perhaps Khenpo Ishi Punsok too. At any rate, these texts are ones that we really must study.
然后菩提心的很多具体的修法，很多具体的修法，就是把这些复杂的这些理论全部过滤了以后，以通俗易懂的这个语言，来讲这个菩提心的这个修法，这个就是慧灯之光，慧灯之光里面有好几种这个菩提心的修法，实际上具体的修法呢，如菩萨心论里面。
So the way of a bodhisattva contains many concrete practices for the cultivation of bodhicitta. But if you'd like to read a more simplified, more abbreviated, condensed description of how to go about cultivating bodhicitta, a practice that is simply that is essentially being filtered down into an easily accessible format, then you can look at the Wisdom Light book series in which I explain these practices.
我们作为一个人，人需要的东西，比如说肉体的需求、精神的需求，需要的东西非常非常的多。但是呢，这个当中我们真正需要的，真正需要的是什么？这个我们必须要知道，然后必须要我们必须要去寻找这个真正需要的东西。
There are all manner of things that we ostensibly need in terms of satisfying our physical needs. However, what we really need to obtain clarity about is what our real and fundamental needs are.
那么真正的需要的是什么？真正的遗憾的是什么？真正的幸福的是什么？我觉得这三个我们必须要搞清楚。
The three things I think that we really need to gain clarity about are what we should be regretful about, what it is that we really need, and what is real happiness.
然后我们认为幸福的很多事情其实也不是幸福，然后我们认为我们需要的东西很多都是实际上也不怎么需要，有很多这样子，所以呢，我们要分清楚这个当中到底我们真正需要的真正幸福的真正的遗憾的是什么，这个我们分清楚了以后呢，我们才能够知道就怎么样去学佛，怎么样去做。
In actual fact, many of the things that we feel regretful about are really not things that we should feel regretful about. Many of the things that we think bring happiness are not things that really bring us happiness. Many of the things we think we need and things not really that we, not things that we in actual fact really do need. So it's important that we are clear, understand what it is we really need. What it is we really should be regretful about, and what it is that really brings us happiness. And it's only by gaining clarity in terms of these questions that we can be sure about how to go about our study of Buddhism.
接下来大家发菩提心的时候，我们要想到，我们一定要让天下所有的众生成佛。我们当然知道我们现在是没有这个。 能力，也并不是说我们现在就去让天下所有的众生成佛，但是呢，我们 就是要有这个心啊，需要有这样子的心。我一定要让天下所有的众生成佛，所以我自己啊要先成佛啊。那么为了成佛，我今天啊听这堂课啊听完了以后呢啊，我就啊这个根据自己的能力啊尽量的去修啊，修了以后呢。 总有一天啊，一定会成佛的。那么成佛的时候呢，我也像释迦牟尼佛一样啊，帮助啊更多的众生啊，利益更多的众生啊，这样子发菩提心，这个就叫做具体的发菩提心的方法。So
let's begin the teaching tonight by generating an aspiration of bodhicitta. So in doing this, we aspire to attain Buddhahood for the sake of all living beings. We recognize, however, that at the present point in time, it's really not possible for us to benefit others in the most effective way possible. So for this reason, it's necessary for us to attain Buddhahood. And in order to do that, we're listening to tonight's teaching. Having listened to tonight's teaching, we will put into practice what we have learnt and eventually attain Buddhahood. And when we do that, we, following in the example of the Buddha, will be able to benefit other living beings effectively.
好，这样子发了菩提心以后呢，我们啊就啊听啊今天的这个主题的这个课的内容啊。那么我们今天讲的是什么呢？就是啊四加心啊。我们昨天已经接受了三个四加心当中的三个加心，那么今天啊就讲这个第四个加心。 因果不虚。
So after everyone has generated this aspiration, we're going to go on to tonight's teaching, the main content of tonight's teaching, and we're going to start off by talking about the last of the four thoughts that turn the mind from samsara that we didn't get a chance to talk about yesterday evening.
因果不虚，就是我们坚定不移的相信。 善恶因果啊，就是善有善报，恶有恶报啊，就是这个叫做因果不虚。So
karma and its consequences. This entails us generating an unwavering belief in the operation of the law of karmic cause and effect, that good actions produce good results and negative actions produce negative results.
那么因果不虚啊，我们怎么知道啊？就有这个善恶的因果呢？其实，善恶因果就是一个非常简单的理论啊，但是因为我们没有看见，所以很多人都不相信而已。实际上，这个理论是非常非常简单的。How
do we go about understanding this theory of karmic cause and effect? In actual fact, it's very simple. The fact is that many people have not observed it, and so for this reason don't believe in it. But in actual fact, it's something that operates in a very simple way.
就像中国的传统文化里面有一句话，就是说"中国德国，众多德都"啊，所有的老百姓都知道的啊一句话。那么这个就是善恶因果的道理。只要接受这个理念，那么善恶因果也就是其中一个。 其中一部分而已。
It's just like the common phrase in Chinese, if you plant gourds, you'll reap gourds. If you plant beans, you'll reap beans. It's exactly the same logic. And so the idea that positive actions yield positive results and negative actions yield negative results is really a subset of this greater logic.
那么这个因果不虚呢？释迦牟尼佛在佛经当中讲过很多很多次，讲因果不虚的这个佛经也有很多很多啊，其中有两个啊是比较重要的，两个佛经啊，一个叫做缘起经啊，另外一个叫做道干经啊，就是这两个佛经啊，虽然这个数字文字上啊不是很多，但是呢。 这里面讲的内容呢，就是一个很清楚的讲了这个因果的这个道理。
Karma and its consequences is something that's really described in a great deal of sutras. However, the two sutras that address this in the most clear and direct way are the Sutra of Dependent Origination and the Salu Sprout Sutra.
缘起经当中有一句非常著名的话，一句话，那么这句话什么呢？就是说如来出世，活不出世，发心常在，就是这句话。这句话的意思呢，就是说释迦牟尼佛出世也好，不出世也好，出世就是佛诞生，释迦牟尼佛诞生也好，不诞生也好。 这个发心是自然的规律，就叫做因果，就像我们现在讲的自然规律就是因果，因果就是自然的规律，这个自然的规律呢，叫做发心，法就是万事万物叫做法，行就是它的本心，它的这个自然的法则，规则，这叫做发心。 发心常在，常在的意思就是说，释迦牟尼佛没有出现之前，因果也是存在的，释迦牟尼佛出世了以后，因果存在的，释迦牟尼佛圆寂了以后呢，因果仍然存在的，所以叫做发心常住。
In the Sutra of Dependent Origination, there's a quote which says, regardless of whether the Buddha manifested on the earth or not, the natural order of things would still exist. And in referring to the natural order of things, this refers to the law of cause and effect, which is in essence the natural order of things. What this is saying is that regardless of whether the Buddha arose or before the Buddha arose, during the Buddha's lifetime, and after the Buddha passed into Nirvana, the natural order of things still functioned as it always had.
所以佛教认为，因果善恶因果，这个不是释迦牟尼佛创造的，释迦牟尼佛出世也好，不出世。 不出世也好，它就是一个自然的规律而已，这个不是释迦牟尼佛创造的，所以呢，因果善恶的因果跟释迦牟尼佛没有关系，不是释迦牟尼佛创造的，而是释迦牟尼佛发现的，释迦牟尼佛发现有一个这样子的因果的自然的规律，但是这个规律不是他创造的。
So really, the law of karmic cause and effect is not something that the Buddha invented himself. Rather, he only discovered the fact that the law of cause and effect operated in the way it did.
所以，释迦牟尼佛也没有办法这个直接去插手这个因果规律，也就是说，直接去干预。 干涉这个因果规律，也就是说，释迦牟尼佛也没有能力直接去改变这个因果，因为每一个众生自己心善就是有善报，自己造罪就有恶报，这个果报释迦牟尼佛也没有办法改变，所以呢，佛教说释迦牟尼佛不是全能。 而是全知，释迦牟尼佛一个人从轮回当中解脱的这个所有的方法全部都知道，所以他是全知，但他不是全能。
So in saying this, the Buddha has no way to influence the natural order of things, karmic cause and effect. The Buddha has no way to change it, to manipulate it according to his own desires. It's something that functions in its own way because it is the natural order of things. So we can see from this that individuals carry their own karmic inheritances, whether it be negative karma or positive karma, and the way that things work out is not something that the Buddha is able to influence. it's something that rests at the level of the individual. So for this reason, the Buddha we describe as being not all-powerful or omnipotent, but rather all-knowing or omniscient.
所以中国禅宗的第五祖弘忍大师，他的最上乘论，这个论里面有一句非常著名的话，就是说佛不度众生，众生自己度自己，意思就是这个佛是没有办法直接改变我们的因果报应，直接让我们往生西方极乐世界，直接让我们解脱，佛是没有这样子的办法。那么佛 把这些所有的方法交给我们以后呢，然后众生自己去欣赏，自己去修行，自己去悟领悟体会，这样子就成就了。所以呢，不是佛来度，而是众生自己度自己。弘忍大师的意思也就是这样子的。
The Chan Master Hongren said that living beings liberate themselves. They are not liberated by the Buddha. In saying this, he was referring to the fact that the Buddha has provided us with the methods, the ways and means for practicing and overcoming our current situation. However, the work of actually practicing the Buddha's teachings, engaging in positive conduct, and realizing the truth of the Buddha's teachings is something that needs to be done by the individual.
如果释迦牟尼佛是全能的这样子的话，那么这个世界上绝对不会有战争，绝不会有饥饿，绝不会有痛苦。我们今天也不会，绝不可能我们在这个轮回当中，佛已经造就让我们成佛，让我们往生西方极乐世界。那么我们这个世界上还有战争，还有饥渴。 还有这么多的不幸福的事情，这就是说，佛不是万能，但是呢，佛只能给我们指出一个解脱的道路。但是这个道路如果我们自己不走，佛也是没有办法的。所以佛，我们只能说佛是全知，他把这些方法全部可以告诉我们，这些方法他非常的清楚，所以他是全知，但不是全能。
If the Buddha were all powerful, then there wouldn't be wars, famine, and suffering in the world like there is today. If the Buddha was all powerful, then he would certainly not allow for these things to happen, and he would certainly have rescued us all from cyclic existence. So the fact that we still exist in cyclic existence and these problems still endure is proof that the Buddha is all-knowing but not all-powerful. He has provided us with the means, he's provided us with the path for overcoming samsara. But in terms of whether we pursue the path and practice it itself, that is something that rests with us.
佛不度众生，自己众生自己度自己。那么我们刚才发菩提心的时候，我们要成佛，成了佛以后呢，我们要去度众生。这两个是不是矛盾呢？这不矛盾的这个角度不一样。弘忍大师的意思就是说，佛即使是把这个所有的解脱的方法都告诉我们了，但是如果我们不去做，那么佛也是没有办法的。所以佛不度。 如果你就是按照佛的方法去做，那么你就可以解脱，所以众生可以自己度。从这个角度来讲，众生是自己度自己的。但是我们平时我们讲成了佛以后就度众生，佛来度我们。那么这个意思是什么呢？就是说，虽然是众生自己去修行，自己去这个修道，但是呢， 如果佛没有告诉我们这些方法，那么众生根本就不知道怎么样去修，所以就需要有佛的教育、佛的教导，才能够我们可以度自己。所以从这个角度来讲，也是佛度的。所以呢，佛度或者自己度，都实际上最终两个都需要的。
It might seem that the fifth patriarch Hongren's statement that the Buddha doesn't liberate living beings, they liberate themselves, and our aspiration with bodhicitta to achieve Buddhahood, to liberate all beings, that there's an inconsistency or a contradiction between the two of them. In actual fact, there isn't a contradiction. On the one hand, it is true that we as individuals have to work on becoming enlightened ourselves. The Buddha has provided us with the path, has provided us with the means to do this, but it's work that we need to undertake for ourselves. At the same time, from the point of view of bodhicitta, it's true that the work is work that we have to do ourselves, but if we were not told about how to go about doing it, if we didn't know, in fact, what the path was, then we wouldn't be able to go about putting the Buddha's teachings into practice. So from that point of view, we can say that, yes, it is the Buddha liberating living beings. So we can see that, in actual fact, these two ways of looking at the situation are both valid.
那么佛为什么不能度呢？就是因为众生受苦，或者是众生幸福等等，都有一个自己的这个因缘因果关系。那众生为什么受苦呢？受苦就有受苦的原因。然后我们比如说在这个轮回当中感受到 暂时的相对的幸福的话，那么这个也不是偶然的机会，也有他自己的原因。所以这些原因都是一个自然的规律，这个就是自然的法则，这个不是谁想改就改不了。所以呢，佛众生就遭罪了以后呢，佛也是没有办法的。所以佛就是要想办法教育大家，不要让大家造这样子的罪，从因 上面呢改变才能够改变果。如果我们制造了这样子的因想改变果，这个是不可能的。所以呢，佛教育我们不要造罪，这是佛度众生。
However, the reason that we generally say the Buddha is incapable of rescuing living beings is because every individual living being has their own karmic inheritance, whether it be positive in terms of reaping fruits of relative happiness in this existence, or negative karmic fruition, which leads to unfortunate ripenings in this existence. In any case, the way that things work out for us as individuals is not a coincidence, and it's not a coincidence. It's not something that has no rhyme and reason. Everything that's actually taking place is doing so according to a natural order of things. However, what the Buddha really is teaching, or was teaching, was that in order to change the way that things work out, in order to change results, we really need to address them at the level of cause. And so it was in order to help us to refrain from creating negative karmic consequences for ourselves that the Buddha taught us to address our behavior and our actions at the level of cause.
在这样子的这个因果善恶因果自然的规律，这个前面真正的所有的人都是平等的。佛教就讲，比如说这个善恶因果，如果一个佛教徒他如果造罪，那么佛教徒也会堕地狱，或者是有这个因果的惩罚。然后有一个比如说基督教徒、伊斯兰教徒或者是其他的这个 这个宗教教徒，如果他做善事、做好事，那么他有好报，比如说佛教徒，如果他造罪，那么他就有恶报；异教徒，如果他遵守这个因果，他心善的话，那么他就是有善报。所以这个是公平的，这个是跟 跟信仰没有关系的，然后跟这个宗族、跟信仰、跟任何这些都没有关系，这就是一个自然的规律。谁心善，那么谁就有这个善报；谁造罪，就有这个果报。所以这是一个真正的名副其实的一个绝对的一个公正、公平的一个 这样子的规律叫做因果。
The operation of the law of karmic cause and effect is something that does, that applies to every single being equally without any distinction on the basis of a person's religious faith or their race or creed or anything like that. So for this reason, a person of Buddhist faith who engages in negative conduct will reap the negative consequences of that. Similarly, people of alternative religious faiths, Christians and people of Muslim faith, for example, if they act in accordance with the law of cause and effect and accumulate merit, engage in positive conduct, then they too will reap the positive fruits of their conduct. So the law of cause and effect really is a natural order of things. It's a natural law that functions and applies equally to all living beings, regardless of what their religious faith or other distinguishing characteristics might be.
啊，所以这个理论就是这么简单，很简单的一个这个理论。万事万物都有因，有它自己的因。他自己的因就会长出他自己的果，就像种瓜就能够得瓜，种豆就不会得瓜，种豆就能够得豆啊。这个理论是非常简单的，我们在现实生活当中、工作当中，任何时候都是这样子啊。这个事情做好了，做得好，那他就有这个好的结果啊。没有去做好，没有认真的去做。啊，没有认真的去做，那就是没有好的结果。这个是我们在这个现实生活工作当中是一个常见的理论啊，我们经常在接受。所以这个理论善恶因果的理论呢，就没有什么接受不了的，就是一个很正常的啊一个自然的规律。
So this law of cause and effect, the natural order of cause and effect, is something really that's very easy to understand, and it's also very simple to observe in our life. It just follows the logic that if one plants melons, one reaps melons, and one plants beans, one gets beans. We certainly don't get beans if we plant melons and vice versa. It's something that we can observe very readily in our everyday lives, that every single phenomena has its own cause and conditions. For example, in our workplace, if we do good work, we'll have good results. If we don't do good work, we won't have good results. So this is something that is not difficult for us to understand at all, and it's in fact something that we see taking place before us every day.
那么为什么很多人不相信因果呢？就是因为他们没有看到，没有看见，这个并不是说有什么，更强的这个逻辑能够推翻，并不是说这个善恶因果就是不符合实事等等不是因为有这样子的问题，而是因为我们没有看见这是一个看不见摸不着的东西，所以大家不相，所以很多人不相信的。
However, the reason that most people don't believe in the operation of the law and cause and effect is not because there is some greater or more convincing logic that readily overturns it, but the fact that it is something they can't perceive, that is something intangible, and because they can't see it, they don't believe in it.
那么我们没有看见我们的这个肉眼没有看见就能够否定吗？能够否定它的存在吗？我们的这个感官有那么可信度吗？原来实际上根本不是，我们的感官没有看得见，根本就不算什么。
The fact that our senses, that our naked eye can't perceive the operation of the law and cause and effect, really isn't a credible reason to refute the operation of this law. In fact, it's not reliable at all.
在这个现实当中存在的，真实存在的非常非常多的东西，我们的肉眼都看不见的，都看不见。比如说昨天有一位师兄提到问题一样，就像我们现在看到的这个天体，包括我们的地球、太阳等等，我们能够看到的所有的物质加在一起， 也就是不到这个无知的4%啊。那么其他的无知啊，大部分都一部分叫做暗无知，一部分叫做暗能量啊。这个物质和能量都是存在的东西，都是实实在在存在的东西，但是我们能看得见吗？我们根本看不见啊。那么我们看不见就能够否定它的存在吗？这个完全是不可能的啊。所以呢，我们的感官没有发现，没有看到，根本就不算什么，没有任何的说服力。
The number of things that exist, that objectively exist, that exist in reality that we are not able to perceive with our eyes are very, very many. For example, in the cosmos, in space, for example, the planetary formations and stars, etc., that we can see and perceive really only constitute 4% of the total matter that exists. That which we can't see, that which we can't see, the majority of everything is referred to as dark matter or dark energy. So based on this, we can see that the fact our eyes can't see something is hardly a basis for refuting the existence of something.
我们的感官啊，很多时候都是连动物的感官都不如啊，比如说三个小时之前有一个人就在我们的这个前面经过了，走过去了啊。那么三个小时以后，我们一个人类啊进来看啊，这个人有没有留下什么东西啊？没有留下任何的东西。只要我们在这个地板上没有发现他的脚印的话，那么我们就感觉不到任何他留下来的东西啊。但是呢，有一条狗啊过来看一下，然后他就立即知道这个地方就是有经过了一个人，而且这个人是一个什么样的，他就能够闻得出来，他就是知道有一个气味啊，留下来一个东西了。但是我们人根本感觉不到，所以我们的感官都是非常非常愚钝的啊，他没有看见根本不算什么。
In actual fact, senses, our sensorial perceptions, our sensorial faculties are often, in fact, inferior to those of animals. In a room, for example, if a person walked across the room 3 hours before, most of us wouldn't know that if the person had not left behind any traces like footprints, for example. A dog, on the other hand, could come along and through sniffing where the person had walked would know that a person had been there and would also know other information about that person. So from this, we can see that, in fact, our senses, the senses that we possess as humans, are in actual fact very dull and limited in nature.
如果我们的感官啊，他看到的都是真实的，然后他没有看到的都是可以否定的话，那么高科技的这些理论统统都不能成立的。那为什么几乎所有的这些高科技的这些结论都是跟我们的感官的常识是违背矛盾的啊？比如说我们看这个前面的啊物体跟显微镜看到的结论完全是不一样，不但是不一样，而且是矛盾的。我们肉眼看到的就是一个静态的啊，显微镜看到的是一个动态的啊，所以我们的感官啊，这个我们的感官没有看到的都能够，我们觉得我们感官没有看到的可以否定啊，这种想法其实就是一个非常幼稚的想法。
If, in fact, our senses, the way that our senses perceive things were to be relied on as constituting the truth, then none of the scientific and advanced scientific theories and conclusions on would really be able to stand. Quite often, the way that we conventionally perceive things and the way that advanced science tells us things operate are in conflict with each other. For example, the way that we perceive an item is some kind of object in front of us, and the way that we would see this object if we were looking through a microscope are radically different. When we perceive this object with our naked eyes, we see an object that is still, that is intact, that is solid. When we look at it through the microscope, however, we see an item that is in flux, an item in motion. So we can really deduce from this that the notion that what our senses tell us is in fact the case is in fact very juvenile. It's a very basic understanding.
所以我们这个要相信因果，那么我们刚才讲了这个我们想否定是否定不了的没有理由，那么我们什么时候能够证明它的存在，或者是我们什么时候能够感觉到它的存在呢？当我们的这个感官提升到一定的这个层次，这样子的时候呢？ 可以看到它的存在，比如说修禅定，修四禅八定，修禅定，然后通过禅定的这个力量改变了我们的这个感官的结构，然后呢，这个时候它不需要理论，不需要逻辑，不需要显微镜，因为它的这个感官就能够 看见这个因果的关系，那个时候呢，我们能看得见，但是我们现在的这个感官是没有办法证明，也没有办法否定。So
if we're not able to refute the operation of the law and cause and effect, then when are we in a situation where we're able to observe it and see it in the way it operates? This is something that we are only able to do through developing and refining our sensorial capacities through engaging in meditative practice. And through completing the different stages of meditative absorption, it's possible for us to develop our senses so that we are able to see and perceive the operation of law and cause and effect. Not relying on theory, not relying on any other support, but to directly see and understand it for ourselves.
在我们的现实生活当中，就是经历过的很多事情，就是科学没有办法解释的，哲学的理论也是没有办法解释的，一些很多很多这样子的神奇的东西，那么这些 从表面上看起来，我们看不出它的规律是什么，它的因果是什么。但是这个大自然，万事万物都有一个，它总有一个规律，它不是一个乱套，它不是一个想怎么样就怎么样，它就是有一个规律。那么这个规律叫做外在的因果和内在的因果。我们刚刚讲的这个倒干净，这个当中就叫 外在的因果和内在的因果，外在的因果就是大自然的变化，它的自然的规律；内在的因果是我们的今生的这个变化，还有这个当中呢也包含了，比如说善恶啊这样子的这些这个因果啊，这叫做内在的这个因果。
Quite often it seems that there are many mysterious things that happen, inexplicable things that happen, things that science and philosophy are not able to explain for us. The fact is, though, that any single thing that happens has a reason, has a cause, it has conditions. There's the world and the universe operates according to the operation of a natural law. It's not powered by chaos. It's not just a random situation. Everything happens according to the natural law of cause and effect. So in the Salu Sprout Sutra, this natural law of cause and effect is talked about in terms of an external law, cause and effect in an external sense, and also in an internal sense too. So external in terms of the world around us, things that happen, and an internal sense in terms of positive actions, reaping good results, and so on.
万事万物它有一个自然的规律啊，那么比如说 达尔文的进化论，实际上他也没有回答最后的答案。比如说，动物和人啊，可以慢慢的这样子的进化。那么即使这个是真实的啊，人是从动物进化来的。那么为什么可以进化呢？为什么动物可以进化成人呢？这个回答。没有这样子，没有这个答案，最终的答案还是没有解决。所以呢，我们的万事万物啊，它有一个因果，这个因果当中有我们看见的因果啊，大自然的因果，看不见的因果，然后呢，非常隐蔽的因果，有各种各样的因果，这些因果就决定了我们今天的一切啊。这个为什么大自然是这样子？为什么我们人？为什么动物可以进化成人啊？然后呢，人最后又会怎么样啊？等等，都有一个它的一个我们看不见的地方，有一个力量，它在操作，这个叫做因果。
Darwin's theory of evolution, even if it is correct, yes, that animals evolved into humans and humans evolved from animals.It nevertheless doesn't answer the final question of why it is that animals can evolve into humans. It doesn't answer the karmic question of cause and effect. The law of cause and effect, however, talks about various relationships of cause and effect that operate in the external world in terms of the natural world around us. They operate in an internal sense, and they also operate in very secret ways too. So cause and effect is something that operates on different levels. Ultimately, though, it is that strange force, or it's the force that is propelling all kinds of things in terms of how they result.This is cause and effect.
好，这些是一个简单的这个善恶因果存在的一个理由啊，简单的说。然后呢，我们可以进一步的去这个学习啊，这些比较讲的比较深入的这些佛经，比如说像宗喀巴大师的《菩提道次第广论》里面讲的特别特别的多，特别特别的清楚。然后呢，像大圆满的前心普贤上师言教里面呢，也就讲这个善恶的这个分类，善恶的因和果讲的特别清楚。那么这所有的这些藏传佛教，比如说宗喀巴大师的，或者是大圆满的前心啊，他们的依据是什么？他们的依据就是印度佛教的这个俱舍论，就是大乘阿毗达摩和俱舍啊。俱舍论是小乘佛教的阿毗达摩，然后呢，阿毗达摩就是指的是大乘佛教的这个。阿毗达摩，阿毗达摩就是印度的这个梵文的一个外来词。那么这本书里面讲的就是善恶因果。这本书里面，比如说《俱舍论》当中有一品是专门讲这个善恶因果善恶因果的分类，然后善恶因果的一切都是讲得非常清楚的那么宗喀巴大师和这个大圆满的前心的。来源都是在这个印度佛教里面，所以我们如果想从源头上想去学习的话，那么应该去学习阿毗达摩，还有就是可以学这个俱舍论等等这些里面讲得很清楚的。
So that is a brief introduction to the law of karmic cause and effect.This is something, if you'd like to study in greater detail, you can do so by turning to the sutras themselves. Tsongkhapa's graded stages of the path and the words of my perfect teacher both discuss the law of karmic cause and effect. The latter of these texts goes into some detail about the different kinds of karmic actions and the different results that they produce.If you'd like to go back to the Indian texts, the Indian scriptures, which are the source for the works by Tsongkhapa and the words of my perfect teacher, then you can turn to the Amidharma texts in particular, and also scriptures like the Jushulun. These contain very detailed and deep discussions of karma.
然后具体的这个修行的方法呢，首先我们要在理论上去学习什么是善，什么是恶，然后什么是善恶因果，什么叫做因果，先理论上学习，然后学好了以后呢，然后我们打坐静下来去思考它的这些内容。
So in terms of going about the practice of contemplation of karma and its consequences, first of all, we need to obtain a theoretical understanding of karma and its consequences, positive conduct and the results it produces, negative conduct and the results it produces. And then after we've developed a good understanding, we need to really sit and reflect deeply over what we've learned.
具体的思维的时候呢，首先要身体做这个毗卢伽法的姿势，然后就是排除无起，然后观想释迦牟尼佛，祈祷释迦牟尼佛，然后呢，释迦牟尼佛融化华光融入自己的身体，最后就是发菩提心，这些我们每一次修。 这个出离心也好，修菩提心也好，或者是我们以后修空心的时候都需要的。但是这些方法呢，我们今天不讲，因为这个我们以前讲过很多很多次了，所以我们可以在这个像慧灯之光的网等等这些上面大家都能够下载、能够搜索，所以我们今天不再重复。
When we engage in contemplative meditation on the four thoughts that turn the mind, we begin by adopting the seven postures of meditation. We then visualize Buddha in front of us and dissolve the Buddha into our own minds. And then we generate an aspiration of bodhicitta. But we're not going to go into great detail about how we go through these stages of meditation preparation today. I've already spoken many, many times about this, and there's a lot of information available online in the Wisdom Light book series. So we're not going to talk about this in much detail today, except to say that these are preparation stages that we need to go through every time we engage in meditation practice, whether it be generating renunciation, generating bodhicitta, or when we meditate on emptiness too.
这些都做好了以后呢，然后具体的这个思维的方式呢，比如说我们修这个因果不虚的时候呢，先把这个什么叫做善。 就善非实际上有很多很多种善，但是呢，佛经里面就主要讲十种善，是善和是不善，那么这十种善，和这个十种不善，的这每一个，比如说，首先，慎造罪。 欲造罪、信造罪，这四个都是有些是我们的身体制造的，有些是我们的语言制造的这个罪业，有些是我们的心制造的罪业，比如说身体制造的罪业，比如说杀生、投盗等等。然后呢，我们语言的这个制造的罪呢，比如说骂人。 撒谎等等，就是这些。那么这些每一个罪，首先我们去学习、去了解什么叫做杀生。然后呢，比如说我们首先去了解什么叫杀生。了解了以后呢，然后杀生有什么样的果报？每一个，比如说杀生。 它也有四种果报，四种不同的果报，然后投盗也有四种不同的这个果报，比如说杀生的话，第一个 杀圣的这个国宝当中，一个是什么呢？就是夺嫡语啊，或者是这个，比如说比较严重的话，夺嫡语啊，不是相当严重啊的话，那就是恶鬼啊、旁身啊，这些都有可能的啊。这是他的这个他的艺术果成熟果啊，然后啊，这是其中一个果。
So after we have done the proper preparations for meditation, we need to sit down and begin by contemplating positive action. What do we mean by positive action? Usually we define positive action as having 10 kinds of virtuous action, and also 10 kinds of unvirtuous action. We can further divide these 10 kinds into kinds of conduct or activity that are generated by the body, different kinds of conduct that are generated by speech, and different conduct that are generated at the level of the mind. So examples of unvirtuous conduct that is undertaken by the body are killing, the taking of life, and stealing. Unvirtuous conduct that is committed by our speech is, for example, scolding people and things like that. So in terms of every one, we need to think in a very detailed way. So for example, about taking life, we need to contemplate what is meant by the taking of life and what are the karmic consequences of taking life. In general, we can talk about there being 4 karmic consequences of taking life. The first, the most serious, descending into hell. The second being rebirth as a hungry ghost. In any case, we need to think in a very detailed way like this.
杀生啊，为什么堕地狱受苦呢？因为啊，就是因为给其他的众生制造了很大的痛苦，所以他自己以后就是要感受啊同样的啊，就是同样的这个痛苦。就是俗人说以牙还牙，就是这个道理，就是因为给别人啊制造了这么多的痛苦，所以现在我们自己要感受同样的痛苦啊。这个就是种果得果的这个理论啊，这是这个四个国宝当中的其中一个国宝。
So why is it that a person who has taken life, killed another human in the most serious karmic consequence descends to hell? The reason is because in killing someone, in taking their life, you have created very, very serious pain and suffering. So as a result, you too have to receive the very, very serious suffering and pain as a consequence of your actions, which generated the same kind of result. So this is an operation of cause and effect. It's similar to, as we say, a tooth for a tooth. And this is one of the karmic consequences of taking life.
那么这个国宝，就是这四个国宝当中的最重的啊，最严重的国宝，就是这个国宝，其他的都是相对稍微比较轻一点的国宝，这个是最终的最终的惩罚啊，最终的惩罚是创造，比如说给别人制造了什么样的痛苦，自己以后就会要感受到什么样的痛苦，这个就是这个四个国宝里面呢最终的这个惩罚，最终的最严重的这个国宝。
So descending to hell as a result of having taken the life of another is the most serious karmic consequence. It's the result of having to take on the corresponding consequence or punishment for the degree of severity of the action that one has engaged in. The other 3 karmic consequences associated with taking in life are less severe than this.
然后第二个国宝啊，第二个国宝是什么样子呢？比如说他这个最终的国宝成熟完了以后呢，啊，这个国宝收完了以后啊，然后稍微轻一点的，比如说啊，他 因为杀神堕地狱或者是堕恶鬼啊，这个果报承受完了以后，如果再回到人间的话啊，还有这个还没有全部结束，这个因果还存在。比如说杀生啊，那么他在比如说下一世做人的时候呢，然后就是寿命很短啊，有些时候呢，婴儿的时候就去世，或者是胎儿的时候就去世啊，等等啊，很年轻的时候就会死啊，这样子这个，因为他把其他众生的这个寿命强制性的结束，所以以后他在堕世累劫当中啊，都是不会有很长的寿命，每一次都是很短很短的寿命。
So the second level or type of karmic consequence associated with the taking of life is after the person has descended to the realm of hell or descended to the realm of the hungry ghosts and subsequently achieves human rebirth. Their lifetime is very short, so they might die as infants or die at a very young age, and this, in fact, might be something that happens over the course of several lifetimes, dying at a relatively young age. So this is the karmic consequence of having forcibly ended the life of another being.
第三个果报呢，比如说啊，这一世当中杀生啊这样子的人，下一世再下一世，如果以后这个这些惩罚结束了以后，他如果再有机会啊做人啊这样子的话，那他也是一个因为过去的这个原因，他就是变成一个喜欢杀生的人啊，就是投身到一个喜欢杀生的人。如果他投身到动物，那也就是天生啊就喜欢杀生的这样子的动物啊。如果做人，如果有机会做人，那也就是天生的啊，就是先天性喜欢杀生的这样子的人啊。我们人当中有些人是先天性啊喜欢投岛的，先天性的喜欢杀生的啊。每个人有很多不一样的这个性格，人的性格啊，科学当然是说跟我们的基因有关系啊，基因有没有关系，确实是有关系，但是呢，人的性格不是完全是基因决定，而是很多大部分都是跟我们过去的啊这个前世的习气啊有关系，所以呢啊第三个果报呢，如果以后他有机会做人的话，那他又就是变成一个喜欢杀生的人啊，然后喜欢杀生，尤其杀生，杀生啊，制造了很多的杀生的罪，然后又啊堕地狱恶鬼啊，这个恶性循环，这叫做轮回。
The third kind of our third level of karmic consequence associated with the taking of life entails after one's retribution has been received of descending to hell, supposing that one received rebirth as a human or in the animal realm, it would be as a human or as an animal with an innate propensity for killing. So, as on account of this innate propensity for killing, one would continue to take lives, continue to generate negative karma, and then would find themselves descending to hell, being reborn as a hungry ghost, and essentially this vicious cycle would be constantly perpetuated, essentially the cycle of samsara. Ultimately, science offers us explanations for why people have various propensities. By explaining it from a genetic point of view, saying that we like to do things, it's encoded in our genes. Of course, there is some truth to this way of saying things, but not everything that we like to do, or not everything about our personality and our inclinations, is determined by our genes. It operates due to karmic consequences we have generated in past lives.
第四个果报啊，下一世无论是人啊还是动物，就会投身到生命没有安全感的地方啊，就是有战争的地方啊，经常 高频率的发生战争的地方，或者是自然灾害很多的地方等等，就是会投身到这样子的地方。这是最轻的一个国宝，但是呢，这也是实际上也是很严重的，所以生命没有安全感呢，这当然很严重啊。但是。 我们在这个四个国宝里面呢，比较的话，相比之下还是比较轻的惩罚。但是呢，实际上这个也就是不轻，生命没有安全感，这是一个很大的问题啊。那这四个杀生有这样子的四个国宝。
The fourth type of karmic consequence is to be reborn in a place where one's life has no guarantee of safety. So in a place that is ravaged by war or in a place of natural disaster, essentially a place where one's life is in constant danger. Even though this is the least severe of the four different types of karmic consequence, it is still obviously very serious in nature.
然后除了杀生以外，这个杀刀鹰王，这个誓不杀，都有每个都有这样子的四个不同的国宝。那么首先我们去学习，比如说杀生有什么样的国宝，四个国宝是什么？哪四个？然后呢，这个头刀有什么样的这个国宝？等等等等。 先全部学好，学好了以后呢，我们打坐，静下来，再去思考，就是思考这些问题。那思考，就是思考这个，比如说杀生，它有什么样的这个国宝？为什么有这样子的国宝？它的国宝是什么样子？就是人的心静下来以后呢，比较容易专注，比较容易专注。那么 专注专心的去思考这些问题，思考这些事情。其实我们这个修出离心或者是修私家心，很简单的，就是这些思考、这些思维，叫做修心。
So it's not just in respect of taking life that there are these different karmic consequences, but in all of the various kinds of unvirtuous or negative consequence or conduct, all have their own respective karmic consequences. And it's these consequences that we need to contemplate when we sit down for meditation practice. We need to reflect very deeply on the different kinds of negative conduct and the negative types of consequence they bring about. And this kind of contemplation or reflection is essentially what we do in our practice on renunciation and on bodhicitta as well.
那么因果我们在理论上学会了以后，然后我们相信了以后， 不就可以了吗？为什么还要去这样去思考？为什么还要去修呢？就是为了我们为了这个坚定不移的相信，或者是我们这个为了巩固相信轮回的这种心性，为了巩固这种心性，所以深入的去思考，所以反复的去思考，这样子以后呢，时间长了以后呢，这个对我们的影响 很大的，所以我们在这样子，我们思考修心，通过修心以后，在这个工作当中生活当中就不容易去犯这些因果，不容易犯错。这个否则的话，我们理论上虽然知道了，但是呢，现实生活当中影响不了我们所以要反复的去思考思维。
Why is it that knowing about the law of cause and karmic effect and consequence and believing in it, why is it that it's necessary for us to contemplate it over and over again and practice it? The reason is that we really need to consolidate our understanding of samsara and the law of cause of karmic cause and effect, and to really deepen our belief, to make our belief unfaltering, unwavering in nature. Otherwise, even though we might have a belief in karma and its consequences in our everyday lives, without really internalizing it and making this belief something very deep-rooted, then it's very easy for us to make mistakes. So this is why it's very important for us to internalize and consolidate our belief in karma and its consequences.
这个四个加薪都是这样子，人生难得也是。首先我们去学什么叫做人生难得，就是去学习这个18个思维的方法，把每一个都要这个学好。学好了以后，接下来去思考，那所谓的大作就是思维。大作当然不是所有的大作都是思考和思维。 大作当中也有思维的，也有没有思维的，有些是有思维，有些是没有思维，有些是有观想，有些是没有观想。大作有各种各样，禅修也有各种各样。但是我们的这个思加心呢，是所有的这个修心的基础，所以呢，它是必须要有思考，因为我们很多很多的我们的价值观。 都是错误的，那么这个错误的价值观要纠正，这样子的话，那就是我们必须要去深入的去思考，思考了才能够纠正。那我们大作什么都不想的话，怎么能够纠正这个错误的观念呢？所以必须要思考。
So it's not just for karma and its consequences that we practice in this way. We contemplate like this for each of the four common preliminaries, the four thoughts. For example, with the preciousness of human life, we have, as we explained last night, the 18 different perspectives from which we reflect on the preciousness of human life. So we do this for each of the preliminaries. We contemplate. It involves us contemplating and reflecting after we obtain an understanding of what we are going to be thinking about. We then engage in the practice of contemplating. This is not to say that all meditation involves contemplation. There are obviously very many different types of meditation. Some involve contemplation, some involve visualization. In any case, for the purposes of the preliminary practices, it's very necessary that we contemplate on these four thoughts, for the very reason that what we're seeking to do is to overturn our hitherto mistaken values and ideas. And in order to do this, it's necessary that we think, that we contemplate, that we reflect. Simply meditating on nothing wouldn't achieve this result.
然后无常和轮回的痛苦都是这样子，先去学为什么是无常，什么叫做无常，或者是先去学习什么是轮回的痛苦，为什么是痛苦，先去理论上先去学，学好了以后呢，然后我们再静下来打坐，然后去这个深入的去思考，反复的去思考。 思考了以后，反复思考以后呢，然后我们最后深深的体会到人生是非常非常难得的，然后深深的体会到，虽然这个人生是很难得，但是呢，逝去这个人生呢，非常的容易的，这个有强烈的感受，然后思考这个轮回的痛苦的时候呢，然后。 反复思考了以后，最后我们就得到一个对深深的体会到轮回确实是太多太多的这个痛苦，这些感受非常强烈。如果我们不这么去反复的去思考，而且大作静下来去思考，没有这种思考，这样子的话，那我们理论上。 知道了，学会了，我们接受了这个理念，但是呢，对我们的影响不深刻，影响不深刻，这样子的话，它不能成为一个我们的修心的动力，它不能改变我们的这个生活，不能改变我们的很多很多的。 不好的心味啊，所以呢，必须要反复的思考。
So, contemplating like this, reflecting over and over again on the preciousness of human existence, the impermanence and mortality, the shortcomings of samsara, after we learn about what is meant by each of these four thoughts, it's necessary that we contemplate them, that we think about them, reflect on them time and time again. And the reason that it is necessary for us to do this is that simply knowing these in theory is all very good and well. However, knowing about it in theory without actually having sat down and reflected on them in meditation, then we won't have internalized them sufficiently to an extent that they're capable of transforming our behavior, transforming our lives, and really bringing us any benefit in this sense.
然后我们这个四个加轻啊都是一样，比如说人生难得要分两个啊，一个叫做人生难得的修法，另外一个叫做人生难得的禅定啊，无常也有无常和无常的禅定，然后因果不虚有因果不虚和因果不虚的禅定，每一个都要这样子分啊。那么人生难得和这四个我们刚才大家基本上知道了啊，这是一个思考的方法。那、那么禅定是什么呢？人生难得的禅定是什么？因果不虚的禅定是什么呢？啊，我们打坐的时候，比如说我们去深入的去思考，非常专心的去思考的时候呢，啊，有些时候我们的这个精神啊疲惫，然后不想思考啊，不想思考。不想思考的时候就、哦、不要勉强啊，不要勉强，在这个时候呢我们可以静下来啊，休息啊，一个休息。那么休息的方法呢就是有一点点不一样的啊。那么这个时候怎么样休息呢？是不是我们就不打坐了啊，去出去啊喝茶或者是看电视啊？不是这样子。这个休息的方法呢就是这个精神思维疲劳思维疲惫的时候就停止啊，不去思考了啊，不要再去想什么，所有的思考所有的思维所有的念头啊都停止啊，都静下来，全部停止停下来。然后在这个状态当中啊，这个状态其实就是没有思维的啊，过去的思维未来的思维啊都本来就不存在。那么当下的思维因为它太疲惫了，就所以不想思考了啊，然后这个时候呢在一段时间当中呢不会有任何的这个思维啊，人的心非常的平静啊，就安住在这个平静的状态当中啊，这个就叫做人生难得，或者是其他四加行的禅定，每一个四加行都有它的禅定，禅定都是这样子的。
So practice contemplative meditation on each of the four thoughts that turn the mind involve a contemplation, of, for example, on the preciousness of human existence, and a meditation on the preciousness of human existence. Now, the first contemplation involves reflection on the nature of the preciousness of human existence. In terms of the meditation, this is something that we can do when we reach a point in our meditation practice where we feel very fatigued, we don't feel like contemplating or reflecting anymore, and it's at this time that we essentially abide in a state of restfulness in our minds. We are not thinking about anything, we don't have thoughts of the past, no thoughts of the future, in fact no present thoughts either, and we simply abide in this state. And this is something that we can do for each of the four thoughts. So it's in this way that practice on each of the four thoughts has a contemplative practice and a meditative practice as well.
然后这个四个加心的这个总的结果是什么呢？ 就是出离心，那么出离心，我们前几天已经讲过了啊。我们通过这个修法啊，在我们的人生当中就有一个非常非常大的变化啊，尤其是在我们的价值观啊上面呢，有一个很大的转变，很大的变化啊。那有什么样的变化呢？这个私家心没有修之前，我们大多数人都觉得啊，我们。 有钱啊，有名啊，有地位，有权利啊，那这样子的话，我们该有的都有了，可以了，我这个人生已经是啊很圆满了，所以我就满足了，我不需要其他的啊，只需要这些东西，我就是为了这些东西而奋斗，只要有这些，我的目的达到了啊，我们绝大多数的人的。
So the combined result of practice on the four thoughts is to is renunciation. Their practice is to enable us to cultivate renunciation, and this is something which has a great transformative impact on our, in particular, our values and our value system. Previously, we might have thought that if we had wealth, if we had status, if we had fame, etc., then this would be enough. This would be all that we would need in order to be happy, and that it should be for these things that we orientate all our efforts in life.
那么修了以后呢？这些都修行比较到位的时候呢，那有什么样的这个新的价值观呢？那么这个时候我们。 比如说钱啊，可以有啊。佛教没有说佛教徒一定是穷人才可以修啊，有钱也可以，没有钱这是另外一回事。嗯，然后地位有地位也可以，没有地位也可以啊。佛教没有要求学佛的人都是没有地位的啊，没有地位才能够成就，有地位就不能成就。 没有这样子的要求，也没有这样子的说法，然后有名声，有权利也好，没有权利也好，这些都有了，但是我们就是觉得还有缺乏了一个东西啊，缺少了一个东西，这都可以有，但是呢，不能没有另外一个追求啊，另外一个追求呢，就是。 超越金钱啊，超越地位，超越名声啊，超越这一切的一个另外一个更高的一个目标。那么这个就是解脱。解脱是什么？我们已经讲过了啊。这个时候我们就修了这个四个四加行以后呢，我们就会有一个这样子的啊这个追求啊，这些金钱。 啊，地位等等啊，都可以有啊，但是呢，我还需要另外一个啊。那之前呢，没有这样子的想法，我觉得有这些就可以了啊。那么修了以后呢，我们就是有一种啊新的这个价值观呢啊是什么？这些都可以有啊，但是呢，这些都有了以后，还需要一个。 不能没有另外一个追求啊，另外一个就是我就是要解脱啊。那么这个出来，这种价值观啊，有了以后，这就叫做这个出离心啊。那这个是我们的最要达到的目标，这个是我们的学佛的第一个目标。
But after having properly practiced the four common preliminaries, then we will reach a point where we aim to have an aspiration, or we strive for something that is higher, that is more than just money or status or fame. While it is okay for us to have these things, and in fact the Buddha never said it was not okay to have them, it was never said that it's not impossible to attain enlightenment, for example, if one has money or if one has status or if one has fame. However, it's really about cultivating a value that is higher than this, a goal, an objective that is, that goes beyond these things. And ultimately, that goal is liberation. We talked about that over the previous few nights. So it's this desire for liberation, going beyond these mundane objectives in life, that is renunciation. That's what we're seeking to cultivate through the practice of the four preliminaries.
好，我们修这个十加行，然后修十加行的禅定啊啊，疲惫不像这个思考的时候静下来，但是在这个静下来当中安住，我们只能安住一分钟、两分钟，然后就又开始升起啊杂念啊。那么开始升起杂念的时候呢，我们这个时候就不需要去控制杂念，这时候就不再休息了，然后进一步的去思考啊，继续思考啊，继续思考人生难得无常啊等等就可以了。这个就是具体的这个修行的方法。当然，具体的修行的方法，我们还要进一步的去啊看书、听视频这样子。简单的说，这个具体修行是这样子。然后结束了以后呢，我们这个修行结束的时候啊，就要回向。那做回向，那么这一切我们今天讲的这个大座的前面和后面怎么做啊？准备大座的时候怎么做？大座之后怎么做？这些都要我们要看一下这个回灯之光啊。第二里面有一个叫做处座与如座的修法啊，如座就是我们去大座啊，处座就是大座结束啊。就是这个，这个时候怎么做？怎么样去入座啊？怎么样去开示啊？怎么样去结束啊？这里面讲得很清楚的啊，大家啊去看一看这个啊阅读，或者是网上有这个啊视频啊，看看就知道了。好，这个就是我们今天的这个课。那么我们本来是要讲这个禅定的啊，但是呢，因为这个十加行是昨天没有讲完。尤其是这个四加行对我们初学者来说非常的重要，所以没有四加行，我们讲禅定根本就是没有用的啊！什么大圆满啊、禅定啊、禅宗啊、明心见性啊，这些听起来非常非常好听啊！我想我们很多人也就很喜欢听，听起来很兴奋、很激动，但是只是兴奋、激动而已，实际上这个没有什么实质性的。得不到什么实质性的东西，为什么？因为我们没有基础啊，没有基础的时候，这些只是听听而已，所以没有用。所以我们还是要修心，必须要脚踏实地啊，一步一步的修啊，才有收获。所以我们今天呢啊就没有讲到这个禅定，但是没问题，我们可以明天讲这个禅定。本来这个禅定呢啊不需要分两天，明天讲就可以了啊。因为这个基础的东西非常的重要，啊，希望大家这个去实修啊。虽然我们的这个时间啊就很紧啊，时间上很紧张，但是呢，还是要想办法安排一些时间去修，实修特别特别的重要。如果我们大家不修啊，这样子的话，那么比如说我们即使是每年讲课的话，也就是。这是只能讲一讲一些佛教的基础的知识呀，一般的这些大众化的这些概念啊，没有办法根据大家的修心的精度来讲课啊，没有办法这样子讲课。这样子的话，就实际的作用是不大的。虽然我们去啊听课，我们可以学一些知识啊，但是这些都是佛教的知识而已。所以，我们如果啊。真的想修行的话，那我们比如说我们现在啊修四加行啊，四加行修完了以后呢，再讲五加行，大家去修五加行，五加行修完了以后呢，再讲其他的，这样子根据我们大家的这个修行的进度来讲课的话，那就是有实际的收获啊，大家有实际的收获。但是如果大家不怎么修心的话，那就根本没有什么进度了。那没有进度，怎么根据进度讲课呢？就是没有办法。所以每年啊，都是降一降四加行啊，降一降菩提心啊。啊，我们很多上师也经常到这个国外，也有非常非常了不起的很多很多的上师，但是大部分的人呢，也就是。 给大家关个顶，然后就降一降一半的这个佛教的知识就完了啊？为什么呢？为什么这样子呢？就是因为我们没有一个时机的啊，习通的啊，这个修行。那如果有习通的修行，那我们完全可以根据这个每一个，根据我们大家的精读来讲啊，这样子就会有收获。就像我们一年级读完了就去读二年级啊，然后小学读完了就去读这个中学啊，否则的话我们永远都是听一听小学的课程就没办法了，大学的课程听了也没有用，我们也不知道像讲什么，所以没有用的。所以大家要有一个实际的行动啊，这个是最重要的。
I really hope that everybody engages in practice. Even though our time is limited, it's extremely important that we actually practice what we've learned. Otherwise, you know, we may come and listen to teachings like this every year or whenever different teachers come, but ultimately without practicing ourselves, then although we may be accumulating knowledge, we're really not developing any kind of experience at our own individual level. So this means then that every time teachers come and give teachings, they are really only able to give teachings on introductory topics or kind of general teachings to a very general audience, and the reason is because they don't have a systematic, or there hasn't been a systematic program of practice outlaid according to which students practice, and so it's for this reason that teachers are not able to give teachings in accordance with the levels of experience of their students. Many teachers come, they give empowerments and they give general teachings, but they're not able to offer more substantial teachings for this reason. So I hope very much that everybody practices diligently.
我们可以参加这个菩提学会的课程，这个里面就有这个从最基础啊一步一步的修，可以参加这个学习小组当中去学习。啊，也可以这个慧灯禅修版，就是一个简单的从四加心最后就修到空心啊，一个这样子的一个实修的引导。那么也可以参加这样子的学习小组当中，一步一步的去修啊。就在国内啊，在中国我们很多地方都是这样子，我们先讲四加心啊，大家去修四加心。那四加心修完了以后，大家都差不多的时候呢，虽然是这个不可能每一个人的水平都是一样，但是绝大多数的人修的差不多的时候呢，比如说出离心修的差不多，那么我们再讲菩提心的修法，然后再讲金刚萨埵的修法这样子呢，因为有人修，所以有一个我们有一个他们的进步进度，那么然后呢我们可以根据这个精读讲课这样子讲课也就比较方便我们也知道要讲什么，然后大家也有收获也有收获，自己有收获。否则的话我们讲了很多很多课这个学了很多的道理，很多人就很多经常听课的人虽然懂很多的道理但是因为没有修，所以烦恼这些还是我们没有修行的人是一样的。这样子的话呢，那实际的效果不怎么样。所以希望大家就有一个实际行动，有一个实实在在的修心这样子我觉得我们的讲课呀、听课呀或者是都有意思。
Two potential options are to take part in the Puti Xiehui study groups, which involve an introduction program that begins at the very basics and starts from there and moves upwards, or the Hui Deng Changxiu Ban, which is a program that begins with the four preliminaries and then progresses through the different stages to meditation on emptiness. In mainland China, this is essentially how we approach the instruction of Buddhist practice. people start off with the preliminaries, the four common preliminaries. After they've essentially cultivated renunciation, then we move on to the practice of bodhicitta, and so on and so forth. And the reason that we do it this way is not that necessarily everyone will have exactly the same level, but there will be, in general, a common level of experience and understanding that we're able to teach to. So whether it be renunciation or bodhicitta or vajrasattva practice. Simply listening to classes is, you know, enables us to learn a lot, but without practicing, then we are really not in a situation to overcome our difficulties. In fact, in terms of our negative thoughts, etc., we're really almost in the same position as a person who doesn't study Buddhism at all. So for this reason, study and classes can be very useful.
好，今天我们的这个课就讲完了，接下来回想回想，对对对对，站起来回想也可以的，没关系。So num de yi dam jo zo ba nya to ne ni be da na ba je ja je ga ma je wa lon to ba je ben to le to a to ro ro sho o ma a ho ba zo ge je ba ma so de Om Ahom Banzangar Bama Sada Om Om Ahom Banzangar Bama Sada Om 谢谢谢谢大家阿弥陀佛阿弥陀佛